Well, howdy there, partner, and welcome to another version of Warbird Wednesday. My name is Fred Bell. I am the vice chairman of the Palm Springs Air Museum. Today, you can tell we are going back to our Texas roots. Somehow we have Texas roots. My trusty sidekick, Hopalong Greg, today is with me. And we are in front of the T-6 Texan, hence my Western gear. This is sort of Western gear. What do you think, Greg? It works. All right, so Hopalong, we're going to toss this off camera to you. Oh, another perfect catch there by my wonderful assistant. Now, today, we're still in trainer land. We're still going through trainers. And what we're talking about is the T-6, the Texan. Now, the T-6 is, remember, we were in primary trainers. We have a really good representation of trainers on the table, some of which we've talked about. There are other trainers that we have not talked about, but these are a pretty good cross-section representation. So now, if you were learning how to fly, and where we were before, if you were learning how to fly and you didn't wreck the airplane or you didn't do something, then you were going to step up to something a little more complicated, which is what this airplane is, the T-6. Now I'm going to walk over here, my wonderful and my longanimous assistant. Did I get that right, Greg? I did. I've been struggling with that word. Greg came up with another tongue twister for me today. But we're going to go into the North American, the T-6. Now, the interesting thing about the T-6 is that it comes from a company that has a very, very long line of aviation products. North American started in their early 20s. You know them for airplanes like the P-51, the B-25, the F-86, the XB-70, the Apollo space program, and Greg, believe it or not, and I was very lucky when I was a kid, I actually got into the plant where they had the B-1A, and I got to sit in a B-1A as they were loading the avionics in it. Of course, North American was involved in that as well. Through all of the gobbling of companies, they have been gobbled up, and they are part of Boeing, and some of them went to Aerojet, some of the assets. So that's kind of where they've kind of gone in their lineage. One thing at the museum, when you go into the Miles Hangar, we have a great bench that was put there by folks that work at North American. It covers a little bit of their history, and you can go see that in the Miles Hangar. So today, we're talking about an airplane that flew under the NA-16 designation in 1935. It had a whole bunch of variants, and we could be here for 2 hours talking about the variants. But this airplane, we're going to talk about the most predominant version of this airplane. About 15,500 built of the Texans. There are about 17,000 built overall. Now, we're getting into this R-1340 radial engine, so we're stepping up a little bit on the engine. Remember, low wing monoplane with retractable gear, so we're getting a little more complex. We're not dealing with fixed gear. Some of the early versions of this airplane did have fixed gear, and we're going to talk about a knockoff of this airplane shortly that actually brings in an interesting engineering component. But so a low wing two place, we'll give you the plan view like we normally do. Low wing, two place. The view of the airplane is now similar to the fighters. It is a tail dragger. It's got a metal substructure. There's still a little bit of fabric on the control surfaces, but a metal substructure. This airplane could be used for a whole bunch of different things. It could be used for flight training. It was used, one variant was used for gunnery training. There were navigation versions of this airplane. There are also radio operator versions of the airplane. So it had a number of uses. And as far as military use, not only was it a trainer, but it was also used in combat. If you believe that, Greg, I didn't know that until I did the research on this. It was used in combat. And it also was used as a forward air controller airplane in Vietnam, believe it or not. I did not know that. The airplane served in military service up until 1995. It was retired with the South African Air Force, and that is where it ended its military service. Now, this boy behind me, this big airplane, is an SNJ version of this airplane. They were known as T-6. It could have been the Harvard. It was flying for foreign service, or it could be known as the SNJ. This is a Navy version. This particular airplane was delivered in 1951. It was in military service until 1955 when it went to Davis-Monthan, and then it was sold off. It had an accident, it was rebuilt, and it made it into the Pond collection, and we've had it ever since. So that's kind of exciting, don't you think? My trusty cowpoke assistant. So this is now a transitional airplane. A couple of things about design on this airplane. This really is the last of the tail draggers, the airplanes that have that tail wheel. And why was that? Why was that? Simple reason, they're going to jets. And what do jets have? Jets were getting up on their front, they were getting tricycle gear, so you wanted, although we still had piston engine trainers being produced, we are now getting tricycle gear because you were teaching, when you're flying an airplane, you're not only teaching how to fly the airplane, but how to ground handle the airplane as well. So what they were doing with this was when they got them up on their gear with later versions, and we are going to move in to some of the tricycle gear airplanes, the trainers. This was kind of the last of that line. But the airplane had a lot of longevity, a great deal of longevity. Now, Greg, I'm going to move over here and have you follow me because there is an interesting sub-history with this airplane that I want to talk about. And that is, I'm going to walk back. I'm giving Greg quite a workout today. I'm going to put this down. Now, there's an interesting sub-story to the T6. The Japanese bought two NA-16s, which were very early versions of this airplane in 1937. Mitsubishi bought them, and they subsequently, some people will say they reverse engineered them, but I'm going to tell you what really happened. Greg, you're like sitting on the edge of your seat about what really happened. The Japanese looked at this airplane, and the airplane, we don't have some of the aircraft, we have a cutaway. But the bottom line is on these aircraft, there we go, one of those great jets going by. Hopefully I'm not losing my audio. This airplane has a substructure, and Greg can get a cutaway of this, but it has a frame, it has a substructure, and the frame and the substructure bear most of the load, the structural load on the airplane. And it's either metal, like this, or there's fabric on the airplane, but the structure, the substructure is either tube metal or tube steel. Now, or tube aluminum, whatever it may be. Now, the Japanese did something, and this gives me an opportunity for the kids at home. This is something that I want you to look up. This structure that the Japanese came up with, and Greg can get a picture of this airplane, the KW-10, the Allied code name for it was Oak, which I don't understand why, you know, they were doing men for fighters, women for bombers. Somehow we got a tree in there, but it was the Oak. But that was the Allied code name for it. It was a trainer. The Japanese pilots did not like it for a lot of reasons. But although it bore a superficial resemblance to the T6, it had fixed gear with wheel pants. Wheel pants, it's interesting. I never knew airplanes had pants, but they have wheel pants. Wheel pants went over fixed gear to reduce the drag of the wheels, kind of like we've talked about the Stuka. The Stuka had wheel pants. But that was where the resemblance ended. Underneath the structure of the Japanese Oak, it was essentially what they call a Monica structure. Now, Monica is a French term. I'm going to have Greg go out and look that up. It is not does not sound like the girl's name, but what it really is and what it means is that instead of a substructure in the airplane, the skin of the airplane provides the structural load for the airplane. And that particular design, now I want you to go out, the kids at home who are always following me on this stuff, I want you to go out and look this up. That's called a Monica structure. The Monica structure, what it means is that the skin of the airplane, or whatever it is, and we'll talk about applications, carries the load. So think about, I'm going to use this egg as an example. Think about the egg. The egg, if you crack an egg open, there's not a substructure in the egg. The outside of the structure, and this is a complex engineering term that I'm going to move through very quickly, and that's why I want you to look it up. But the structure of the egg carries most of the load, or carries all the load, right? And you have all the goodness inside, whether it's the little bird or whether it's your breakfast. And Greg is going, yay, breakfast. But that is the structure. And if you push on that, you can feel it gives you resistance, because the structure of the egg provides the integrity of the outside of this. That is what was that airplane. Now, interesting side fact, you have the normal subjects in this. You had Dornier and Zeppelin. Dornier, who did the first work on all metal aircraft with that particular structure, the Monaco structure, and he did this while he was working, Greg, at Zeppelin, if you can believe that or not. So he came up with that, so very familiar names. Now, you're saying, and I'm sweating here, Greg, I probably lost about 10 pounds, where this hangar, it is the record heat that we're doing right now, and so it is a little warm in here. But why is that important? Well, that's important because that type of substructure, although it's not part of the Texan, it's worth a conversation, because that particular structure can be found in boats, it can be found in aircraft, and what else, Greg? What else that we use all the time now, and really important because we just launched one last week or a few days ago to Mars, a rocket. Rockets have that type of substructure where, whether they're pressurized under their skin or the structure of itself, then that saves weight because you don't have all that substructure, and it's, at times it can be really strong. So although the Texan didn't use that, the Japanese did when they knocked off this airplane, and that's the best way, they copied it, right? They went to a completely different engineering design, although it looked like very similar to the T-6. There were only a couple hundred of them made. None of them survived the war. If any of you have an oak, and I'm not talking about the tree, sitting in your backyard, give Greg a call. We'll gladly take it. I don't know what we'll do with it, but we'll take the Japanese trainer. But that is an interesting sidebar on the T-6 Texan. Now, the one thing about an egg, and we have to do this for my trusty sidekick, is Greg, the structure protects a tasty treat for you. There you go. So you have a little treat, and I'm going to toss my egg to you off camera as well. Oh, a very good catch. Now I'm going to move over here. So these aircraft, there were about, total versions of the airplane are about 17,000 of the Texans built, if you can believe that. They also are movie stars. This airplane, or this type of airplane, was actually in the in a Pat Benatar music video. You can look that up. And the other thing about them that is quite interesting is, and it's fitting because we just talked about the Japanese knocking the airplane off. We did the same thing and returned the favor. When did we do that, Greg? We did that with Tora, 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 where we took the T-6s and Harvards and we modified them to look like Japanese airplanes. So we basically, and that was kind of where I was going with this, Greg is like, where are you going with this? There's this weird connection where the Japanese copied this airplane, and then many years later for a movie, we used it to copy their airplanes. So what the heck? What comes around goes around, right, Greg? I mean, what can I say? So now I'm going to move into my stage two. And my stage two today, it drank, and it is sweating too, Greg, practically sweating the label off. This is, fittingly, Dang. Now, Dang is a butterscotch root beer. It is the original Dang. I didn't know that there was a knockoff. We were talking about knockoffs. There was a copy of Dang. It was bottled in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, by the Imperial Beverage Company. You're taking my calorie count back up. There's 120 calories in this one. But Greg is looking out for me. This is gluten-free. Gluten-free, Greg. So we're going to pop that. All right. Now what we're going to do is we are going to salute a young man today, Grayson Winfield. Now, Grayson Winfield is a fourth grader, and he is over in South Carolina. And Grayson wants to be a Navy SEAL. So fittingly, in front of an SNJ, Grayson has started an effort called Helping Footprint. And Helping Footprint helps veterans and people in need. He's been out mowing lawns of veterans that can't mow their lawns and doing all kinds of good work in his community. So Grayson, I want to say thank you, and thank you for what you're doing, and thank you for paying it forward, buddy. You may never see this video, but we know what you're doing, and we want to say thank you here at Palm Springs Air Museum. So a little bit of my dang. Dang. Oh, I missed it. Dang, that's good. I missed that. So that is part of their marketing effort. Now, I want to say Dang is not a sponsor of this program. I can't say that I like it or I hate it. It's sweet, Greg. You're giving me sugar, so I can certainly enjoy this. But I'm going to keep it because any opportunity to get sugar, Greg, I will not turn down as long as it doesn't turn into another one of the we've gone away from incident. It's now the poisoning assault that you did with me with that 400-year-old drink you gave me or whatever that was. So we'll keep our dang here. Now, if you are a future pilot or you know a future pilot, and we're going to get on to our gratuitous product placement, you need one of these hats. Go out to our website and check out one of these hats. They come in a variety of colors. They do say future pilot on it, so, and they come in all kinds of kid sizes. So go out to the website and pick one of these up for that future pilot and that kid that you know wants to go flying with you. So that is the gratuitous product placements. Now, when you come to the museum, one of the things about these airplanes, you can see they're all painted brightly colored. This one is very brightly colored with the unit. It actually has the setup. It's pretty much set up for flight training. That big radio dome on the back there, and we also have a lot of commemorative stuff from various pilots that went through the training command. In fact, we have this one right here, which is actually commander of one of the training command units. So when you go through the museum, you're going to want to check out all these exhibits. Remember, it's one thing to talk about these airplanes, and this airplane wasn't super high performance. We'll talk about that a little bit in a second. But it's another thing to remember the people that operated them, because we can talk about how fast they are, or how big the engine was or whatever. But all these airplanes were operated by people. And in this case, you can come to the museum and see the exhibits about the training command. We talked a little bit about even Palm Springs at that time. And to the east of us is the Salton Sea. There are at least 40 aircraft at the bottom of the Salton Sea. Did you know that, Greg? All kinds. Avengers, Helldivers, everything. And because the Navy and the Army Air Force did a lot of training out here. The one other thing that is a little known fact about this particular airplane is that there is a crash site east of here up in the Chocolate Mountains that I've been to by helicopter, believe it or not. We went up there and looked at it. It is an SNJ that was lost up there, hit the mountains. Now, this area was so remote at that time that and this is crazy when you think about it today, Greg, they actually had to send out, they didn't find these guys. They had to go out and send a search party out for this crash site. They found the crash site about 6 months later, if you can believe that, and they found there were fatalities there. And anytime you come across a crash site, one advice I would give you, and there's a lot of them in the national parks and stuff like that, you don't know what happened. Treat those crash sites with reverence, because there may be a crew that was lost with that. In this case, they actually had to, the friends of the pilots sent a crew out to find these guys. The military had basically said, they're gone. And they actually sent a crew out to find them, and they actually found their remains. The airplane is still there. It is not an airplane that we will reclaim or take any parts from. It is a lost crew crash site, so it is essentially a war grave, but it's only about 20 minutes from here, and it's up in the mountains. So these airplanes played a huge role. Now, what was their historical context? These aircraft played a huge role. We talked about turning out pilots. One of the keys to the Allied victory in World War II was the ability to outproduce and out-train the Axis powers. You have to remember that we turned out probably about 3.5 to 4 times as many aircraft and pilots as the Axis did. And right at the end of the war, the Axis, whether it was the Germans, the Japanese, or their allies, simply could not keep up with the human losses. And they suffered increasing losses throughout the war in various battles. They were never able to replace those losses. They could produce, if you look at especially German aircraft productions, the Germans, despite the fact that they're getting bombed constantly, and the Japanese to a certain extent, they were able to continue to produce airframes, which is amazing. The quality of the airframes fell way off, the quality of the metallurgy and the quality of the construction, but they were unable to replace that human component, which is the pilot. And this airplane on our side and the Allies was key to turning out the number of pilots that we needed. Its ongoing legacy is that you can see them at air shows, and they're all over the country in air shows. They fly. You can buy rides in these airplanes across the country, but they're primarily right anymore in enthusiasts' hands or at air shows. And they, when you go up and you see these guys, thank them for doing this, because this is carrying on a bit of aviation history. So that concludes another episode of Warbird Wednesdays. My name is Fred Bell. I'm the vice chairman of the Palm Springs Air Museum. I want to thank you for joining us today. Remember, get out to the web store and get yourself one of those future pilot hats. Hit that subscribe button on YouTube and like us on Facebook. We very much appreciate you joining us, and you have a good day, y'all.